This week marks the start of the biggest advertising operation in American history, the campaign to elect a president. John Lindsay, the mayor of New York, is the only new model on the market. People like the bodywork, but they're not quite sure about the engine. Hubert Humphrey, the former vice president, bounces back into his third presidential campaign. They say he's a loser, but that's what they said about Nixon in 68.
What a pleasure to see you.
Well, I'm glad to see you all here.
And then there's George Wallace, governor of Alabama, who returns to haunt the others with the memory of the third-party campaign which he led in 68. All candidates use advertising, all need slogans. Jerry Della Femina, who runs a successful advertising agency on Madison Avenue, is one of the best slogan writers of them all. Does he think that selling a politician is the same as selling a soap powder?
Exactly the same, as far as I'm concerned. You'll find a product, part of the product that looks the most appealing to a housewife or to a consumer, male, and then you go out and you exploit it and you sell it and you play on people's fears or people's weaknesses or people's hatreds or people's love. The same thing happens with a soap powder. You're working on a woman's fear of having her home look dirty. In the case of a politician, I guess it's their fear of having their country look dirty or something like that. It's really the same principle. You have the same copy session. You have the same art director sitting around. You talk about him as though he was a soap powder. The politician is referred to as him. It's not by name. You look for one particular thing. He might be a complete maniac, animal, but you'll find something good about him. Hitler loved dogs. I'm sure you can do a great campaign for Adolf Hitler. I'm sure you can do a great campaign for Genghis Khan. I'm sure there isn't a single man. Ivan the Terrible had some fantastic campaign attributes. You can sell almost any politician.
Advertising agencies that handle political accounts deny this. They say that they don't create images. They don't sell products.
Well, as I've said, they'll look at a politician, and the first step is he's a politician, and then he'll come in and he'll say, I'm going to spend $1 million on my advertising campaign. And then they look at him and say, my God, he's not a politician. This man is a statesman. And then they'll look a little closer, and he'll say, well, I may even spend $2 million. And they'll say, well, this man is even too good to be president. We should try to figure out a way so he can become a world dictator. I think it has a lot to do with money. I think that they sell them, and in their heart of hearts, they really know that what they are selling is a politician, is a product. It's no secret that the man who helped put together the Lyndon Johnson campaign almost had a nervous breakdown when he discovered what he had sold the American public and suffered because of what he had done. Later on, they always stopped and think, what did we do and what did we let go of?
The race to the White House is a long one. Senator Muskie, the Democrats' leading contender, has to perform well in most of the 24 popularity contests, called primary elections, to convince his party that he's the one to take on Richard Nixon in the presidential elections in November. This week, he won the first primary in New Hampshire.
Hi, I'm an intern of yours in Washington.
Good to have you back up.
Hello, Senator.
I'm Mr. Muskie.
For the next 9 months, Ed Muskie, like the other candidates, will be shaking millions of hands and listening to hundreds of bands, not all of them in tune. Candidates need a band, but above all, they need advertising agencies to see that they play the right tunes. Senator Muskie uses the same advertising agency that handled Bobby Kennedy. And they also sell orange juice, tea bags, and toffees, besides Ed Muskie.
One moment, please.
How do you design an advertising campaign for Muskie?
Well, we started by trying to think of one central idea or theme or one statement about the man, hopefully about the man, in some cases about the country and the time. Our first effort, of course, was just to take the name and do the simplest thing you can. We added an exclamation mark after it.
Why?
Well, to get a little excitement in there, to get a little excitement about the man, a little urgency about, you know, our need for him.
And we thought we had to go farther than that.
Well, it means, but the exclamation mark does mean that it's an exciting idea that Nixon can be beaten.
Or he's an exciting man.
Well, for whatever reasons he's exciting. Not to invest him with excitement, but to demonstrate his exciting
But it
aspects.
Is interesting, all those kids up in New Hampshire are spelling his name that way.
This picture that we culled from, you know, really a thousand of them, that we thought best represented, you know, really the warmth and the warmth of the man.
What's it all, I did, really, you know.
Another attempt at the same idea was a line, Believe Muskie, which right now is indeed being used. Believe Muskie, because there is such a lack of belief in really what government is saying to its people, and in some cases, a lack of belief in the people by the government. And so we thought believe was a good word for Muskie.
Don't a lot of people think that he's really rather gray and boring?
Well, we do, of course.
But you always do feel that way about your own kids.
That's right.
I don't think he's gray and boring.
I think the more the people see him, and the more they see him in contention with, say, a Nixon, or with the other candidates that he's running against in the primaries now, the more they see him, the more they're going to be convinced that, in fact, he's not gray and that he's not wishy-washy. In fact, he isn't.
He's
and
not,
that has got to emerge.
He's not supporting a tremendous cause. He's the front runner. He's running, I'm going to unify the party, unify the nation kind of a campaign, which is what he should do.
How important is advertising in a campaign like this?
Or the media, I think, are important. They, the media do have an impact because that, no matter how intensively we play what I call retail politics, that is the handshaking politics, we can't possibly hit the number of people that television and radio does.
How important is Florida to you?
Well, they're all important. We have, you fellows have a way of asking questions as though this whole primary process is going to end with one election. There are 24 primaries. It is, there's no primary that I can foresee having an apocalyptic effect that settles it all, you know, that is a one-round knockout punch. I just don't see it, and I don't see any candidate winning all the primaries. That would take, a major political miracle. So we're all going to have ups and downs, I'm sure, as we go along.
Muskie, I guess, has to be sold as honest Abe or Honest Ed. I guess they'll try to keep him from saying anything because I have a feeling he's going to bore a lot of people to death. So and he's a safe candidate. He's winning, and so he's going to play it very safe. And I would try to get him to be a little bit more outgoing, because I fear that he's going to just pull himself into a shell to keep from losing. And I would sell Muskie as honest, just the way everyone else will sell him. It's Honest Ed, and he's a man you can trust. The word trust is going to be an awful lot. Trust Muskie. Trust Muskie. He's honest, he's straight, he's clean, and he looks like Abraham Lincoln.
Do you regard yourself as an Abe Lincoln figure, Senator?
No, sir. I consider myself an Ed Muskie figure.
The second hurdle the Democrats have to face is Florida, whose voters will decide next Tuesday who is their favorite Democrat. John Lindsay has to sell himself well in Florida and show that he's got what the others haven't, or he's finished. And he's flown in 50 advance men from New York to help him with his image.
Rick, can I ask you what you're doing, Jerry?
We're handing out Lindsay shopping bags, sort of an advance campaign for the mayor to introduce the people to him, to make him know exactly, you know, who he is, that he is the mayor of New York and he is running for president. A lot of the people are not familiar with his name.
How important is Lindsay's image in this campaign?
That basically, I would say 80% of the campaign is image. We're working heavy on the TV, on the radios. We're not too much on billboards and things like that. But basically, it would be all strictly image. He comes in with the open collar, and that he is seeing the people, speaking to the people, shaking hands with the people. And we also cover the media.
What sort of image are you giving Lindsay? What's he like to the consumer, if you like?
Well, we want to show that he's not just a man who sits in an ivory tower up in New York.
Excuse me, madam, do you know who John Lindsay is?
No, I don't.
Who is it? Do you know? Oh, you ask me now, do you know?
That's why I'm asking you.
I don't know, do you?
What's the bag you've got?
Oh, he gave me this hand. Somebody handed me this bag a while ago. I don't know who he is.
Excuse me, madam. Do you know who John Lindsay is?
Yes.
Who is he?
Mayor of New York.
What do you think to him?
Well, he's all right. Just leave him stay where he is.
In New York?
Yeah. Clean it up good.
You don't want him down here?
Oh, no, we don't need him down here.
How would you sell John Lindsay in Florida?
I would hide his jacket, his sport coat. I'm convinced that John Lindsay is either he has his brains in his armpit, or the fact is that every time Lindsay has risen to greatness, it's because he's taken off his coat and walked through a street in his shirt sleeves. Apparently, the man does better without his jacket on. So the first thing any wise agency would do would be to take away his jacket.
All presidential candidates need endless stamina and a permanent smile. John Lindsay, like the other candidates, will go anywhere, meet anybody, and eat anything. At a Florida strawberry festival, he eats, of course, strawberries. The next stop, it may well be Kentucky Fried Chicken. But Lindsay's biggest campaign asset is not his appetite, but his sex appeal.
Tyler, the chairman.
Wonderful. Hi, can I give you a kiss?
What do you think of Mayor Lindsay's visit?
Well, Mayor Lindsay is really handsome, and I like his curls. I like to put my finger around his curly hair.
Oh, nice. I like all of him.
All of it!
All of him?
All of him. Him.
Running for president. Who does John Lindsay remind you of? Who does he look like?
Oh, Jesus Mary, who would he remind me of?
Like Roosevelt.
Roosevelt? No, more like Kennedy. More like Kennedy. John.
Lindsay is the most interesting because he does want to be. He does want to be John Kennedy. And he's got this. He's got the looks. He's handsome. I mean, lots of tight close-ups of John Lindsay in the next election. Otherwise, he's in terrible trouble.
Scotty, man. I don't know.
Okay. Well, let me get in the hot, for heaven's sake. Okay.
Don't you ever get fed up of kissing babies and eating chicken and playing balls and things like that?
I never get tired of eating chicken. I only kiss babies if they're over 18, it's after dark.
What? How would you describe your image in Florida?
I don't know. I'll tell you after the primary, March 14th. I never describe myself. I just run as best as I can.
Well, I want to express, first of all, our thanks, and I say our thanks on behalf of Mrs. Humphrey and myself.
Hubert Humphrey is a talker, never at a loss for words. Even at 9 o'clock in the morning, he will deliver a complicated policy document on social welfare to 200 old age pensioners. And no one can do it with quite the same sincerity as Hubert Humphrey.
I want them to be welcome.
Everybody respects Humphrey, but there's a feeling that he's been around a bit too long. After three presidential campaigns, an old face needs a new image.
It's good old Humphrey. Let's give him a try and let him try. He can't become president. He's a perennial trier. He doesn't quite know what to do about it. But it's nice. He gives the whole thing an air of... He's a piece of the past that we needed. If it wasn't for Humphrey, we'd have to import someone else.
For goodness sake, so good to see you. Good to see you.
Where was your home?
Minneapolis.
Good, great to see you again.
Right.
Thank you.
See more of you.
I remember. Of course I remember you now.
Good.
You betcha.
Good.
I see
Ralph Keller and I.
Yes, sir. You bet. I remember in the office there with Ralph. Yeah. You bet.
Good.
Thank you. Thank you so much.
Bye.
Thank you. Thank you so much.
Is there a new Humphrey this year like there was a new Nixon in 68?
Well, let me put it this way. There's a Humphrey that is out to win and one that feels very much at peace with himself and ready to do a good job for this country.
Are images important in this kind of campaign at all?
I suppose they are every place, but what's more important is what you are, not what the image is, but what you really are.
A campaign is not always what it seems. Television and advertising can make an event seem more important than it really is. A mass rally can be the candidate addressing rows and rows of television cameras and not rows and rows of people. At this meeting, Humphrey was due to meet hundreds of Latin Americans, and the media turned out in force to record it. The cameras were there, but the Latin Americans weren't.
Well, approximately 100 Latin Americans from the Latin American Dade County Democratic Club are going to come in one or two busloads, and the senator will speak to them for approximately 1.5 hours.
They'll be brought in, will they, by bus?
Yes. They're organized by the Dade County Democratic Club.
Because at the moment, it appears that press outnumbers spectators by about 300 to 1.
Yes, that's correct. I don't know what else to tell you. That's what we hope for, is that the Latin American Dade County Democratic Club will come through.
No crowd arrived, but the big star turned up. Not Hubert Humphrey, but the man from Bonanza, Ben Cartwright.
Howdy, Mr. Cartwright.
Howdy, Lorne Green.
In a campaign like this, how important is it for candidates to be seen with big film and television stars like yourself?
Oh, I don't know if it's important at all.
Doesn't it make a difference when Lorne Green's up on stage with Senator Humphrey?
Well, I hope it does. I hope it does. I don't know if it does. I'm here simply because I wanted to do everything I could to help him.
When Hubert Humphrey finally arrived, there was still no one from the Latin American Dade County Democratic Club to greet him. But like the old trooper he is, Hubert managed to find the odd Latin American he could shake hands with and went on to speak passionately to an empty park.
In my rather inadequate Spanish, muchas gracias. Muchas gracias a mis amigos, cubanos e latinos. It's a very great pleasure to be here with you today.
On the television news that night, the film of the speech showed Humphrey only and gave viewers the impression that he was addressing a large election meeting.
Would it be fair to call what we've just seen here a media event?
Oh, sure. Well, obviously, there were more newsmen here than there were people to hear Hubert Humphrey. And
do you feel that you're being used?
Oh, yes, we're obviously being used. There's no question about that. I rationalize it by saying, well, when I put the senator on the air tonight, some people who couldn't come out here tonight, they'll see what he stands for. But obviously, we're being used.
Have you ever handled a politician?
One. It was a terrible mistake in my life. I did it on a freelance basis for a local politician, a man who was running for mayor of a major city in the United States. And I remember going to meet the man's campaign manager, and I said, I'd like to meet the politician. And they said, oh, that's impossible. Nobody gets to see him. And I thought for a while, and I said, okay, well, maybe you can help me. Can you tell me, what is this man for? And the man said, oh, that's very simple. He's for getting elected. And I said, well, can you tell me what this man is against? And he said, oh, sure, this man is against losing. Now, armed with this fantastic information, I was able to come up with a very good campaign for this man.
But the one candidate in Florida who doesn't need an advertising agency is George Wallace.
The United States, you could see Wallace!
Florida is Wallace country. Wallace says what he wants to say and says what the conservative Florida voters want to hear. Wallace takes pride in the fact that he's built up his own image, that it's not the work of a smart advertising agency. His crowds are the biggest of any candidates, his impact the greatest.
This is your campaign, and I'm here in this campaign because you know that the dose of liberalism that has been placed upon us by these academic visionaries and all this radical left and these liberals has brought us what? They brought us dope addiction in the street and disaffected youth, violence and crime in the street, and people chomping up and down, calling for communist victory, and an ever-bottomless tax pit for the average middle-class citizen here in Homestead in the country. When they call me an extremist, you know who the extremists are in these races? The extremists are those that want to disarm us, that have taxed us to death, that have let law and order break down, that have given our money by the billions to welfare loafers, given our money by the billions to foreign aid and busing our little children. Those are the extreme actions today. So when they attack me in the next 2 weeks in this campaign, they're attacking you because I'm your voice. I'm your instrument. And when they say things about me that tend to believe, that let you believe they want to get rid of Wallace, they're not trying to get rid of me. They're trying to get rid of you.
Secretly, a lot of people want Wallace, and they won't admit it. If you wanted to go by polls, Wallace wouldn't have a chance. But underneath it all, there's a little bit of Wallace, I think, in a lot of people right out there in that street. And if you could bring that out, this is, again, cynical, but if you could bring that out, the commercial is George Wallace sitting there with a little baby in his lap, which is probably his baby. I think he just had a baby. And his wife and his family, and it's a beautiful home scene, and the commercial can start. They say that George Wallace is a bigot. Well, if a man is a bigot because he wants his child to go to the best of schools, then maybe George Wallace is a bigot. And if a man is a bigot because he hates people getting away with without working while other people work hard for a living, well, then maybe George Wallace is a bigot. In the background, you hear music. This whole thing is narrated by John Wayne. And if it's true that a man who doesn't want his children to go to inferior schools is a bigot, then George Wallace is a bigot. But I think a lot of Americans, and this is John Wayne's voice, it's beautiful, I think a lot of Americans may want these things to happen. And if it's true that a man who believes in the American dream is a bigot, then George Wallace is a bigot. But maybe this November, you should be voting for a bigot like George Wallace. Cut. Nice commercial for him.
Other candidates use advertising people and media men. Do you have any people like that, Governor?
Yes, I have a lot of people like that. The average man out here you see in Florida is my advertising media.
Do you have an advertising agency?
Oh, I have to place our little ads and so forth, but I don't have any Madison Avenue folks. Folks are tired of old Madison Avenue makeup folks.
What's the impact of your participation in this campaign on the other Democratic candidates?
Well, they're all beginning to sound like me. They're beginning to say things they never would say before. Now they're talking like I'm talking, because that's the way the majority of the people want them to talk. It's been a healthy effect. Folks in this country are tired of the breakdown of ethical and moral values in this country brought about through liberalism, and they're going to put a stop to it beginning in Florida on March 14th.
George Wallace may not need Madison Avenue, but serious presidential candidates do. In 1968, politicians spent £30 million trying to sell themselves to the American electorate. In a television democracy, images mean votes.
Don't you have a very great responsibility in creating a television image of a man in an age when elections are now decided on television?
Of course. Yes, I can't even say that. You know, advertising used incorrectly by the wrong people couldn't hurt the American political scene. It could. I know it is. I mean, it's silly to sit here and pretend that it isn't a dangerous thing, because it can be dangerous. I happen to think that we are all responsible, and I think everybody who is practicing it today is responsible. That isn't to say that maybe the wrong person, the wrong group, and the wrong candidate couldn't misuse it, but I have tremendous belief in the people, in the American people, in really being able to see through that, and maybe that's what carries. That's what carries me through that particular fear. I don't think you can really sell a bad product in your whether you're doing political advertising or you're selling Jell-O. I think if the people don't want the Jell-O, they aren't going to buy it, no matter what you tell them.
Is there a difference between selling a soap powder and selling a politician?
Well, there's one very important difference to me, and that is that if a housewife hates the soap powder that I sell her, she can give it back, and she'll get her money back. If I sell her a politician, she's got to wait 4 years before she can give him back.